Move.
You're too big. You, a little bit closer. I like you. We're ready. We're ready. Welcome, everybody. Welcome back to the Voodoo Garden. My name is Ray. I am the host of the Voodoo Garden. What the Voodoo Garden is, for those of you who don't know, I still do. I have a second channel called The Voodoo Garden. I stopped filming on that one, even though there are hundreds of wonderful programs over there. If you want to go over there, the link is below this program. You can always go over there. I have a huge archive of great indoor gardening programs. They're fun. They're educational. Most of all, they're fun. Okay? That is the F word. That is what I go for when I'm doing my indoor gardening. I decided to move the filming on over here to the Praxis 55712 channel because I'm kind of stuck indoors and I can't do any programs outside, so I kind of commandeered the other channel. And that's okay. That's okay. I have some things I want to show you. If you're looking around, I know you are. Some people listen to me. Some people are like, he just talks a lot, so I just look around. Yeah, and that's okay. Whatever you come here for, that's fine with me. I got some things I would like to show you today because there's been a lot of changes since the last time we did an update on the indoor food forest I got going on here. Radishes, still growing. Yeah. I got so sick of these things. I know they're delicious, but when you eat one of something so much, eventually you get sick of it. So now I eat them just rarely. I'm waiting for the flowers. The flowers are going to come up. Yeah, radishes will put out flowers. Then they'll put out seed pods. That's what I'm waiting for, the seed pods. So you guys need to hurry up and start producing. I got some things I'd like to show you. We got flowering stuff over there. When you walk into this room, you're assaulted with this wonder. It's a great way to be assaulted with a wonderful fragrance of pumpkin flowers. Yes, pumpkin flowers. Yes, there's some good stuff growing on here in the Voodoo Garden. Come on down over here. We're going to start with this sprawling tentacle mess, alfalfa. I love that color. This is alfalfa. Yep, this is what the flower clusters look like on alfalfa. Not something that you normally see. These ones have already gone to flower. I tried to pollinate them by tickling them with my finger. I guess we'll find out if they produce seeds. The leaves, gosh, there's a lot. Let's back up a little bit and see if I can get this all in one frame. I don't think I can. It's a pretty wide plant. All of this, yeah, all of this, all the way over to the back, the right, and then all the way over to the left. This is all one plant, and they do fork. I mean, they do have new starts that come out of the stem. Let's just pick this one up and move you in. See, this is not a leaf cluster. This is a new stem coming up right here. It does that all along each stem. It'll do that. It just lays down, and new growth comes out. This one will eventually lay down. And that's what I've been doing. Every now and then I just push these down. It brings the light down into the center of the plant so new stuff right here can start growing out. When I mentioned for folks, by the way, yeah, this is one plant you can see down here. There are not multiple plants, even though it looks like there are. If you lift it all up, it all goes back to one main stem down there. Yep, not a lot of soil either. Look at that. Just a little pot of soil in all of this plant. I do mention in a couple of my programs about growing alfalfa for soil fertility, biomass to till into the soil. But you can eat it. You can eat it. It's got a good flavor to it. You can just pick the leaves off. What I normally do when I'm picking leaves for salads, I do that about maybe 3 times a week. I come in here and I pick random leaves off of this plant and many other plants, and I have a good mix of greens for my salad. Yep, just as a side dish, not as a main dish, and that's how I enjoy it. Now the flowers are probably edible as well. I'm going to move over back here, this monstrosity that you saw at the beginning of the program. Look at this. This is Vates collard. I just call it collards. Vates is just the brand. Or the type of collards. There's a bunch of different types. This one looks like a cabbage, and it tastes kind of like a cabbage, only more flavor than regular cabbage. The leaves outdoors, I'm sure, would get monstrous. In here, I consider them monstrous, but I'm sure compared to outdoors, they're not considered that large. All in one, yeah, one plant, all in one tiny pot. Now that was I guess it's not a mistake because I didn't know. So it was an on purpose. I planted it in one pot because I thought I'd just have a small plant. I was wrong. Yes, Ray was pleasantly wrong, I was. Yep, the leaves come out, they go down. I've cut off a couple of them, not a lot, because I wanted you to see this before I butchered it. And I am going to butcher it today. Yep, I'm going to take off all of the larger leaves, and I take out the center rib and give that to Bucky. He loves this stuff. And the darker stuff on each side of it, I chop up, and I'm going to put it into a salad today. Not an actual regular salad. My type of salad is a bunch of different mixed greens, whether it be lettuce, the kales, different types and flavors and textures. Then I just hit it with a little bit of olive oil, a little bit of vinegar, seasoning salt, garlic, fresh garlic, mix it all up, and I serve that as a side salad. Just something simple, nothing spectacular. Little things. And this isn't really quite so little anymore. This is the Prax cherry. One plant, not very old. You've seen this, I've talked about this extensively. This one here is the mother plant. It is one plant, goes all the way down to the bottom, and I haven't really done much pruning on it. I've taken two cuttings, and the mother plant is already putting out flowers. If you ever want to pollinate your tomato flowers, all you have to do is go like that. Just tap them. There are most tomatoes, not all, but most, the majority of them, have enclosed flowers, which means the male and female parts are enclosed and they don't show to the outside, so they don't need pollinating insects. All they, whenever the plant moves like this, the pollen goes from one part to another, they pollinate each other, and this one right here has been pollinated and the flower's dead. But inside, there's an itty bitty tomato that's gonna be starting out, and I'm gonna have cherry tomatoes. Today is minus 11 to 12 degrees without a wind chill. That is the regular temperature today. It's Sunday, and that is the temperature. Right now, actually, it's negative 7, and it's going to be negative 11 later on today. So it's going to get colder as the day goes on, but indoors, oh, my fingers smell wonderful. My fingers smell like tomato plant, and that suits me just fine. I'm having a great day. Let's push our way through the jungle. This is the crimson clover. That's the one that's known for its flowers, although it is a beautiful plant, isn't it? This is, I think, three little plants in here. And I just snip off a leaf every now and then, but I just love to touch it. It feels like velvet. Yep, this is the one that grows the flowers that you can eat or make tea out of. It's called crimson clover. And it makes a nice little indoor plant, doesn't it? This would be good any time of the year by a window. You have clover in your house. Yep. Yeah, this one here, it's kind of ugly. This is the Swiss chard. It did so well last year outside, but this year, well, this is indoors. It did okay, but it didn't do great. Look at that. Yeah, it's not that special. I'm taking this thing out today. I'm going to rip it up by the roots. I'm going to chop up everything that's edible and give everything that's unedible to the goat. So that means the stems. I'm going to turn that into goat poo. And the chickens will probably pick it off as well. But these are wonderful. These are what I want out of it. Even if it's wimpy looking, it's delicious. I should do a commercial. It may be ugly, but it's delicious. Right back here. I had to show you this. It's not much, but it's nice. This is the corn plant. And I mentioned that I was going to cut it off at the top. I think I mentioned it, or maybe I didn't. What I did was right here. I cut the plant off right here last time out after the program, and I wanted to know if it would fork, you know, send out new, and it didn't. It just kept growing out of the center. You can see these cut parts? Those were the cut part of the leaf at the top cluster, and it kept growing, but it didn't grow any wide leaves. But it kept growing a stem, and then it put out a tassel up there. That's where the pollen comes from. The only problem is it went off to the side. So when the pollen fell, it wasn't going to hit this. So I had to take the pollen onto my finger, and I came down and I pollinated the tassels, and I got a little ear of corn. I got a little ear of corn. I don't feel anything in there, though, but it's still kind of cute. I grew an ear of corn inside. Oh, I'm having a good time. You know, they're not all, you know, it's not success and failure for me. It's not always a matter of did I get something in the end. It's just that I had a darn good time along the way. One little piece of corn is keeping me so happy. And up from the corn, this is the showstopper. This is the main event for today. Look at the vine. I gotta say, I am just enjoying the heck out of this vine. I had to get up and up close and personal because I want to show you how this grows. It's just a wonder. Yeah, if you get right in here, see, I didn't tie this up or anything. This plant is doing it all itself. But when you go right up in here, pumpkin vines and other vines, but pumpkin vines especially, put out these tendrils and they reach out looking for support and they'll pull themselves up onto other things to grow, to get more light. Because when they grow, generally on the ground, they have to put out these tall leaves in order to get above the grasses naturally to get the light. Here, see, they put out tendrils. They're just growing around the corner. They're putting out more, but they're right underneath this light. And when it came over to the lights, that's when it really started getting strong. Look at this. This is a flower, and there's a bulb at the base. That means it's a female flower. There's more than one, too. There's a few of them. Look at this one. There's one. There's another one. There's another one. All the sisters are on this side of the plant. And this is what they look like. This is the inside of a female flower. It'll have multiple, like it looks like a cauliflower shape in there. A very large area inside of there. And when they opened up this morning when I came in, this is why I had to film today, because I opened up the door. I thought, what's that smell? It smells good. It's pumpkin flowers. Normally, they just have a very mild smell that you can barely pick up. But when you get them in groups, that's when the fun starts. Look at this. We're going to move over here. See, these are the boys. Yep, they kind of hang back on the plant. I have quite a few of those. See, they opened up as well. So what I did, or what I'm going to do, actually, for your benefit, I'm going to show you what I do. Let me put the camera down here. Don't worry, I won't hurt you. Put the camera right down here. This is how I do it. I usually take scissors and cut this off, but I don't want to get the scissors. And then I take the flowers. I don't take it all the way to the base, though, because there's pollen in there. I take it like this. And then I eat these. These are delicious. These can go into a salad. I want to set this right next to you. Don't eat it. It's mine. It's not yours. And then you can see the pollen that fell off of this thing. This is what a male flower looks like. It doesn't have that large area that the female does. See? Yep, that's the male. There's pollen on here and there's pollen in there. What I'm going to do is I'm going to pick you up and pick up the flower, and I'll meet you over at the female flower. Normally bees would take care of this, but since there are no bees in here, I am the bee. I take the male flower, rub it all over the female flower, poke it in there. Make sure that the base of the male flower touches it too, because there's loose pollen in there. And I do that. I do that to all the females, but I do it with more than one male flower to make sure that there's a variety and there's a lot of pollen there. Will this produce a pumpkin? I don't know. I'm going to find out in the next week. What'll happen is after today, the flower will close up and not open up again. Like this one here, the older sister, the pumpkin flower, will just shrivel up. You don't take that off. Don't ever try and yank that off. You could hurt it. It may scar the outside. But I just let it fall off, and then if it's going to form a pumpkin, it'll start growing. This bulb will grow. Or if it's not going to form a pumpkin, right over here, what it'll do is it'll shrivel up. See that one on the right there? Yep, it'll shrivel up and die. And none of them have taken so far, but I'm hoping that since it came up to the light here and it's stronger, it can support them. See, these plants aren't stupid. Like I mentioned before, they're not stupid. They're delicious, but they're not stupid. What they'll do is, see, before this, it was down over here and it wasn't getting as much light. It pulled itself towards the light all by itself, and now that it's closer, it's getting stronger. And that's why I believe it put out all these females, because now it has the strength. So I'm crossing my fingers. There's no guarantees. There never is with growing. But I'm hoping it's strong enough to form a pumpkin. Can you imagine? a pumpkin's hanging off my ceiling in the winter. It's going to be great. Oh. One last plant. This is something that I thought was kind of weird, and I had to show you. Michihili. Michihili Asian cabbage. not to be confused with bok choy. I mean, they're all delicious, but there's different kinds of everything. It's such a variety out there. This is the one that I stole from the little shop of seeds. I took one seed. Yes, I did. I stole it and I planted it here. This is what it looks like. I've mentioned this before and I've shown pictures on Facebook, but I've shown this also on my program. Look at how huge these leaves are. And they are delicious. I have chopped so many off of this plant, and normally they go straight out, but recently, ow, I got poked by it too. They do have little spines on them, which is really kind of weird. Anyway, what it's been doing lately is the leaves have been curving down. Now, at first you think, oh, it's got to be out of water. No, no, no. I check the soil on a daily basis. Every one of my plants gets checked by me. This one is doing fine, and I think what happened is it knew it was time to flower. So what it does is the leaves get out of the way. They point down. Yep, they're not stupid. And then it's sending up a stalk. Have you ever seen this happen? Kind of like on cabbages and stuff. It sends up a stalk. And look at this. Like broccoli. Not cabbage, but broccoli and stuff. Clusters of flowers are growing on here. I'm going to pollinate them. Yep, I shall have seeds. Normally when something starts flowering, the leaves turn bitter. And that's their natural way to keep animals away so they don't eat them as much while they're producing the seeds. Early on, they're delicious. Later on, not so much. But that's my Mitchell-Healy, the life cycle of a plant. One seed can bring you so much happiness. It's fantastic. Sprawling, gangly, unwieldy, and yet it's so delicious. No wonder cows like grazing on this stuff. If I was a cow, I would like it too. The flavor reminds me of clover. And as a kid, I loved clover. By the way, clover over here. I always loved clover. Whenever me and my cousins would be out in their yard, they'd be out throwing the football and stuff, and I'd be crawling around on the ground because they had clover everywhere. Bees buzzing all over the place. They had sweet clover. I don't know what kind of clover that is compared to other kinds of clover. All I know is we called it sweet clover. And you get the young leaves and you pluck them off and they were sweet. This isn't sweet, but it still has that flavor. It reminds me of when I was a kid. I just love it. And that is the tour of today's garden. I hope you enjoyed yourself. If you have any questions at all about the garden or anything like that. Oh, by the way, I know that somebody's going to post a question because I did mention the low temperatures outside. Negative 11 today. Yes, that's what it's going to be today. Now, the first thing you're going to wonder about is the animals. Are they going to be okay? Yes. Yes, they are. First of all, the two dogs, Tanner and Rascal, I get on a coat, thermals, everything. It's an event. I put on my stocking cap, my gloves, everything, because in this type of weather, it's not just dangerous, it's deadly. And so I urge everybody to be very, very careful of their critters. You may seem warm, they may seem warm, but their paws, they can get frostbite just as easily as you can. So when I let them out, I open up the door, they run out, I stand outside with them because if they're going to be miserable, I'm going to be miserable too, and it's more likely that I'm going to bring them in quicker. So I go outside, they know I'm out there with them, they pee, they poo, they do it quick too. When it's -7, you don't waste any time. They literally go out there, go squat right as they get outside, do their business, run towards the door. I get them inside the door. It usually lasts 30 seconds. That's their bath break, bathroom break. And every single time they go out, I go out with them and make sure that they're okay. So no worries about that. The critters that are living outside, cats, goats, chickens, things like that, they're in the coop. I made sure I sealed up the coop as best as I can to keep any kind of air drafts out. I got the lights running on a timer out there so they have daylight, nighttime, so it simulates day and night because they can't see out, you know, they can't be outside, so I give them that. I also took two oil heaters. They're about this big by this tall. You've probably seen them in the stores. They can't start a fire. They don't have an open flame or a filament or anything like that. And I take them, wire them to the cage, to the wire of the fencing in there so that they can't be knocked over, jumped on, or anything like that. The cables are kept out of everybody's way, run along the roof, and they're run 24 hours a day. They don't make it warm in there. No way in heck am I going to be able to heat that unheated, dilapidated mess I call a coop. But what it does do is it takes the edge off. It brings the temperature, I think, from -11 to about maybe 20 or maybe 10. And that seems awful cold, but for those animals, they're acclimated for winter. And that's a normal temperature for them to be outside in, and they're perfectly happy. So the animals are well fed, they get extra treats, they're as warm as I can make them, and they're happy. I go out there and I bundle up and I sit with Bucky and I give him all the attention I possibly can. And the cats, they're all over me, on my head, on my shoulders, everywhere. It's a good day. Anyway, thank you for joining me. I do appreciate it. Don't forget, next time you come in, we're going to have a weekend edition. That's where if you have a question concerning plants, pets, happy stuff, sad stuff, serious stuff, it doesn't matter. If you have a question, I have an answer. And I got some good ones. I got to tell you, I got some good ones for next time you come in. I hope you'll join me for that. It's going to be fun. Thanks for joining me, everybody. Have a great week. Bye.